Darwin thought evolution was a very slow process. "We see nothing of these slow changes in progress," he wrote, "until the hand of time has marked the lapse of ages." But even while he was writing this, natural selection was darkening the wing color of the now famous peppered moth via improved camouflage against the soot-covered bark of trees in industrial age England. In just 40 years, the second half of the 19th century, all the peppered moths in England had changed from white to black. So, after legalization put an end to air pollution in the 1950s, it took another 40 years for them to change back. The peppered moth evolution is the first example of what we now call HIREC, Human-Induced Rapid Evolutionary Change. No other agent is changing the environment as fast and drastically as humans are. We pollute air, soil and water, we fish and hunt, we dam rivers, change the climate and light up the night. We introduce exotic species and pets into the environment. In areas that are strongly influenced by humans, and by the middle of this century that will be almost anywhere on Earth, wild animals and plants will need to either adapt or go extinct. And besides the peppered moth, we now have a whole list of organisms that display HIREC. Sometimes this even leads to so-called speciation, the evolution of two species where first there was just one. Speciation is what creates splits in the branches of the evolutionary tree of life, and normally it is a slow process. But when humans are involved, it can happen much faster. I will now show you a video where I talk about natural and human-induced speciation. All right. So, I'm collecting cave millipedes here.
Here's one.
Which are blind and pale and have relatively long legs and long antennae, and those are characteristics that you often find in cave animals. We're here in a tropical cave in Malaysian Borneo, and as you can see, it's dark here. The temperature is high, the humidity is high. There's very little food. The food that is in the cave is brought in by bat guano and the occasional dead leaf or dead piece of wood that makes its way into the cave. So we see that the organisms that live here, millipedes, but also beetles and isopods, woodlice, springtails, all these tiny insects and other invertebrates, that they have adapted to these conditions. This is a very extreme environment, and they have adapted in very extreme ways. Often you see that they have lost their wings if they're insects, that they have lost their eyes, that they have lost their pigment, that they have a very long digestive system to make the best out of the little nutrients that there are in the cave. And from DNA you can tell that sometimes this cave evolution has taken place very rapidly. In just a few hundred thousand years you can get from a regular outside insect to a very extreme and adapted cave insect. And that's what makes these tropical caves so fascinating to study rapid evolution. So until recently, the habitat outside of this cave was primary rainforest, tropical rainforest, and that's where the ancestors lived of the organisms that are now living inside the cave, that are adapted to cave life. But in the meantime, a completely man-made habitat has appeared here over the last few decades of rows and rows of identical introduced African palms, oil palms, and you could imagine that organisms are going to be forced to adapt to that man-made habitat, just like they've been forced to adapt to the cave habitat. So
So the extreme environment of caves is able to make new cave-adapted species evolve. In the same way, the extreme environments created by humans also makes new species evolve. We now have cases of birds living in cities and insects on agricultural crops that are splitting off from their wild ancestors and evolve into new species. You can find some examples of this in the reading materials that accompany this lecture. The important thing to remember from this lecture is that evolution can go very, very quickly if the selection pressure is strong. And human action does create such strong selection pressures. This means that humans are influencing the evolution of life on this planet in irreversible ways. But it also means that some species may be able to survive environmental change by evolving adaptations, a kind of evolutionary rescue. However, not all species may be able to rescue themselves evolutionarily. See if you can think of some limitations, perhaps using what we learned in Module 4 on evolution's restrictions. The activity at the end of this module allows you to go out into your own neighborhood and see if you can find real-life examples of HIREC where you live. In the next lecture, we will look at the future of HIREC as humans will increase their influence on the planet more and more.